Thank you all for coming here. We'll just get started with our presentation. One thing a few people have asked, and in terms of whether there's a handout, the way we do this is whenever we give a major presentation like this, we upload the PowerPoint slides that evening. So you'll find this on our website. I'll give the web address at the end, but if anyone is dying to know what it is, it's naasurvey.com. That's the National Asian American Survey.com. Thank you for coming out here, and special thanks to the various supporting organizations that have helped with publicity and getting the word out about this event, including the Asian American Federation of New York, APIA Vote, Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund, CHIA, CDC, National Asian Pacific American Bar Association, OCA, the New York chapter, and is it WIPASEC? Thank you for your support. And this, I should note, this is one in a series of presentations we've done across the country. We did one in DC and in LA just before the 2008 election. And since the election, we've had presentations at Berkeley, Chicago, and here in New York City. Just going to give you an outline of our presentation here. I'm going to talk about the background for the survey and talk a little bit about the sample, especially the New York metro area sample. I'll talk about findings from the 2008 elections, and then my colleague Jane Junn will talk about voter turnout and access. And going beyond this two-year cycle or four-year cycle of voting participation that a lot of us care about. Taeku Lee will then talk about Asian American opinion on various issues, and some of the findings here may be counterintuitive or surprising to some of you. And then he'll also talk about political parties and mobilization. And then finally, Janelle Wong will talk about racial identity, discrimination, and potential for coalitions with other groups. And then finally, she will conclude with civic engagement, which will hopefully be a starting off point to enable people here to talk about various efforts that are already underway in terms of political engagement, political participation. Okay, just to say a little bit about our background, the background to this study. With an audience like this, you don't really need to talk about why it's important to pay attention to Asian Americans, but we had to cobble money from various sources to do this, so this is the way we justified it. It's a very fast-growing population. Many of you are familiar with figures like these, going from less than 1 million in 1960 to nearly 15 million residents today. Asian Americans are also a very diverse population. So whenever Asian Americans are talked about in the media, they're just talked about it in very simple terms. Now there are previous data collection efforts by ALDEF, by APOC and other organizations during elections to show that this is a remarkably diverse community, and we see our survey as part of that tradition. The way we design our surveys to give enough voices to the largest Asian American groups, at least, to show that there might be some important differences. Another reason why it's important to specifically pay attention to politics, there are a lot of public health surveys and social surveys and economic surveys that have significant Asian American populations. But in terms of political surveys, Asian Americans are relatively absent. This is most starkly apparent during the primary season, in which there was a lot of speculation that Asian Americans were voting against Obama because of his race, ignoring the possibility that they might be voting for Clinton because of high name recognition and happy memories and good feelings from the 1990s. So Asian Americans, even though they're a large and growing population, are relatively absent from politics and in discussion of politics in mainstream polls and in the mainstream media. So this is why we are doing something like the National Asian American Survey. This is the largest telephone survey that we know of its kind, and what was great about this is that we were able to secure the funding just in time to do it for the 2008 election. We got over 5,000 respondents. And just to put this in context, when you look at surveys from CNN or the New York Times, the sample sizes usually are in the ballpark of 1,000 respondents. Sometimes some of these surveys will go up to 2,000 respondents. But the Asian American sample in these surveys are so small that usually they don't even report out what Asian Americans think about or care about. And most of these survey interviews are done only in English and Spanish. We were able to do these interviews in 8 languages. So 40% of them were done in a non-English language. And this is important because if you're looking at survey data that's based on English language interviews, you're missing out on 40% of the Asian American adult population. So we did these surveys in Vietnamese, Korean, Mandarin, Cantonese, Tagalog, Japanese, and Hindi. We also tried a valiant effort to try to get Hmong interviews, but it was very difficult to do telephone surveys with this population. We used an experienced survey firm, but it ended up being too cost prohibitive to do it. In terms of what our sample looks like, we have very good coverage of the 6 major national origin groups. It does drop off significantly after that, and we also had some challenges trying to get enough Filipino interviews because our methodology was to do a combination of a first name and last name analysis. And as many of you know, it's difficult, given the overlap with Hispanic names, to uniquely identify the Filipino population. That said, we do have a large enough sample nationally, I think, to say important things about Filipinos. The way we designed the surveys, it's a nationally representative survey, but because some of our funders were interested in particular regions, so the James Irvine Foundation cares mostly or exclusively about California, so we bumped up the California numbers a little bit. The Eagleton Institute at Rutgers University cares a lot about New Jersey and the New York metro area, so we have more data there as well. And then the Russell Sage Foundation, where we are all spending this month, cares about immigrants and new destinations. So we have a fair number of interviews from more recently settled areas for Asian Americans. We used Interviewing Service of America, which is arguably the firm that has the most experience conducting surveys of Asian Americans. And then we used Catalyst as our vendor for the sample. In terms of what our survey looks like, and I apologize for some of the technical jargon here. Basically, this says, what's the national origin mix of people in our survey? And what we find is that our survey doesn't look that much different from what Asian America looks like, with the big exception of Filipinos. As I said before, we had some significant challenges trying to get a sizable Filipino population within our survey instrument. What you see on the right in what Taeku assures me is Yankee blue is the sample characteristics for New York Metro. And what we find there is what the Asian American population of New York Metro looks like, primarily being heavily composed of South Asians, Chinese Americans, and Korean Americans.
So correct me, just go back that slide. The national sample is our survey, and the middle
is the American Community Survey. So we could use 2000 census data as a benchmark, but because there has been population growth since then, we use the American Community Survey, which some people have referred to as a rolling census. It's not quite the same as the census, but it's the closest thing we can get as a comparison to our survey. So let me just say a little bit about the 2008 election. There's no suspense here. But we all know who won. But when it came to Asian Americans, there was a little bit of a suspense heading into the general election. And part of it was because you had a very large proportion of Asian Americans, even in October, right? So a little over a quarter of our survey respondents said that they were undecided. And these are the people that drive everyone else nuts, right? It's like, how can you be undecided a month before election day? And it's important to note that a much higher proportion of Asian Americans said that they were undecided than in these national averages. So nationally, the maximum that you found was somewhere around 8 or 9% during this time period, but for Asian Americans, it's over 25%, and that's important to take note of. Among those who have who had decided, the vast majority of them favored Barack Obama over McCain. And I should note that that our results here in terms of the Obama versus McCain matchup tended to be very similar to what was found from the exit polls done nationally and also by all of us. In terms of different national origin groups, the picture isn't that surprising. Vietnamese Americans are exceptional in terms of having very strong support for McCain. All other groups favored Barack Obama to varying degrees. Filipinos were the most lukewarm, I guess you could say, in terms of their support for Obama over McCain, and Japanese Americans and Asian Indians were the strongest in their support for Obama over McCain.
Great, thanks, Karthick. I'm Jane Junn from the University of Southern California. Just recently, I have moved from Rutgers University, so I am a New York metroer at heart. I'm going to talk to you about a couple of things, voter turnout and access. And I think that what's interesting about these data with respect to where we find ourselves now is in understanding the population of Asian Americans, not only in the United States, more generally, but in the New York City metro area. We have some data in these slides that speak specifically to that region. And what's useful about these data is, as a group of community organizations, to understand your population, to know what the dynamics are of that population and how one might think about mobilizing and bringing new voters, new activists into politics. So let me first give you a little bit of data on the relationship between not only national origin, but from citizenship to voting. And so what this table gives you is a breakdown by all the various ethnic origin groups that we have, the six major groups, and it provides for you the proportion in each one of those columns, what proportion are citizens, what proportion are registered voters, what proportion voted in 2004, how many of them were primary voters, and what proportion of them are going to be likely voters or said they were likely voters in 2008. And there are a number of things to notice. By the way, the very final column to the right on the total column gives you the proportion for all of the population put together. There are a couple of things of note. There's a lot of data in here, but a couple of things of note. In the first place, once Asians become naturalized, and they become naturalized relatively quickly compared to other groups, and once they become naturalized, they vote. And I think what's useful and interesting about this is to note that Asian American populations then are not sort of lying about waiting to become legal U.S. citizens, but then after that they do take part in politics. In addition to that, we've also asked people in the survey whether or not they would vote for, if they had an opportunity, to vote for a candidate who shared the same background as them, Chinese American, Filipino American, for example. Would they be more likely to vote for that candidate if they were equally qualified? And as you'll see in the total column, the vast majority of Asian Americans who were asked this question replied yes, meaning that if you run a candidate, a co-ethnic candidate, or an Asian American candidate more generally, Asian Americans are more likely to come out and vote for that candidate, all else equal. There are some interesting differences between various ethnic groups, with Chinese Americans being least likely to say, along with Asian Indians, and Korean and Vietnamese being most likely to say that they would vote for a co-ethnic candidate. The next question that we asked about was in-language election materials. This is very important with respect to the about 40% of the population who, in our study, who were interviewed in their native language, a language other than English. So we asked them if the election materials were available to you in your language, would you make use of them? And as you can see, a disproportionately large numbers, very large numbers, proportions of people say they would have used in-language materials. And if you just look across the columns, you'll see the difference between Asian Indians being very high. You should note, however, that Asian Indians were the least likely to do the interview in Hindi, in this case, which was the only language we supported. Japanese Americans were the least likely to say they would use in-language materials because Japanese Americans are primarily second generation and beyond, so English probably isn't first language. Nevertheless, the importance of this, the takeaway for as you go forward into the next election cycle, is knowing that Asian American voters, particularly those who have English as a second language, really need in-language election materials, or at least they say they do. A similar story can be told here in terms of news on politics. In particular, we ask people whether they use, what kind of media they use when they're searching for information on politics, English only, both, ethnic media only, and then in terms of the type of media, whether it's television, newspapers, internet, and radio. The final column on the right gives you the blue column, gives you the proportion of people in the New York City area who say they would use ethnic media only. And if you can compare that to the column just to the left of that in white, you'll see that the New York area Asian Americans use ethnic media exclusively at a much higher rate than do, in particular for television and newspapers, as well as radio, than do Asian Americans across the United States. So the availability of news in their native language is very important, or at least in ethnic media sources, very important, particularly for information and politics among Asian Americans in New York. Let's move on to talk about some aspects beyond voting. And these are all relevant to everyday, sort of the everyday life of politics. There are a couple of things that characterize, sort of caricature rather, Asian Americans as the mainstream media have portrayed Asian Americans as uninterested in politics and being distrustful of politics. So we ask people these questions: how interested are you in politics? What you see here is a relatively small proportion of people say they're not at all interested in politics, 22%, which is about the same as it is in the U.S. mass population. On the other hand, if you look at the top two bars going horizontally, you see that 40% of Asian Americans in the United States say they're very interested or interested in politics. That's also not too far away from what Americans in the mass public say. I think in many ways sort of discounting the notion that Asian Americans are uninterested in politics, at least in the United States. Similarly, there's the notion that people, that Asian Americans in particular, are more distrustful of government. So we asked this question as well, and we found the question was, are people better off avoiding contact with government? Only 19%, again, a small proportion, less than 20%, less than 1 in 5 say they would strongly agree or agree somewhat with the notion that we shouldn't be trustful, we should be distrustful of government. The next slide here, this is a big, long slide with a lot of numbers in it, and what I want to emphasize here are all the different types of activity we asked about. Political scientists tend to focus on voting as the most important act of participation in the United States democracy. In many ways it is. However, on the ground, you know that people are doing all kinds of other things in addition to voting. And that would include on the roads here, discussing politics, working with others on a community problem, contributing money, visiting online sites, contacting officials, working for candidates, protesting. And we also ask people whether or not they took part in the immigration marches in 2006. And what you see here is it's divided again in the columns by ethnic origin. But as a summary, you can see the column for all Asian Americans put together in the far right column in orange. And what you'll see here are robust political activity among Asian Americans in the United States. These numbers, by the way, are very similar to the New York City metropolitan area. In some cases, Asian Americans are more active than the mass population. That is whites, blacks, Latinos, and all of us, in the one activity, which is working on a community problem, which is quite interesting. They participate at similar rates in things like working for candidates and protesting, but lower rates, for example, with respect to contributing money and contacting officials. And you'll see that there are differences between the various national ethnic origin groups, and the data will be available for you on the website, so you can, if you need the details, you can write about them later. One other thing of interest, the taking part in protest marches in 2006 is very low proportion, and I guess Koreans are the highest, that's interesting, 1.6%, much lower than studies done of Latinos in the United States, but of course done at times which were much closer to the period of the demonstrations themselves. One of the things that, the last thing I'm going to talk about is transnational participation. There is, another sort of, I don't know if it's an urban legend that says that Asian Americans are much more concerned with their home country. They don't care about what's going on in the United States. And all of their energy is taken up by participating in the politics of the home country. So we asked about this, but we asked about it in a number of different ways. How did people take part in the politics of or the life of their home country? And if you look at the three rows, the three questions we asked were whether or not in the last 12 months you've had contact with friends and family, you've sent money back, or if you've participated in the politics of home country. If I could call your attention to the bottom row, and then on the last column, four, which gives an entry of 4%, a very small proportion of Asian Americans in the United States actually take part in the politics of the home country, but a much larger proportion send money back to their home country and stay in contact. And the highest, some of the highest proportions being among Vietnamese Americans and Filipinos with respect to sending money home in terms of grievances. So now, policy views and salient issues, Taeku Lee, University of California, Berkeley.
Good afternoon. I'm going to continue our strategy of trying to hold your attention by mixing up DJs. So I'm going to sample from two different parts of our survey. One is on policy issues. What are the things that Asian Americans think about on various policy issues, which are things that you, as Karthick said earlier, we usually don't get much of a sense of because of the low number of Asian Americans in most media polls. And then also one really important political institution, which is where most political scientists start and end, which is the role that political parties play in shaping the politics of Asian Americans. So the first thing to say is we designed our survey in the spring and early summer months of 2008, leading up into the election. And we went many different rounds trying to figure out, given the resources that we had, what were the what we thought would be the most important policy issues going into the election and into the next administration. And one of the things that we couldn't have foretold in the spring and early summer of 2008 was the fact that financial markets would essentially crumble beneath our feet, and that it would be sort of the determining issue of the election and has been sort of the overriding issue of the national political agenda. Having said that, when we asked our survey respondents an open-ended question, so tell me what you think is the most important problem facing the United States today. An overwhelming number of our respondents, and these were people who were interviewed in August, September, and some in October. So most of our sample was before the financial markets crumbled. Overwhelmingly identified the economy as being the most important problem facing the United States today. We also asked people a follow-up question as a way of trying to allow Asian Americans to define themselves what is the Asian American political agenda. A lot of times, the idea of what is the Asian American political agenda is something that community-based organizations or advocacy groups or government employees or academics like us try to decide, but instead we wanted to just allow people to say what issue is most important to them personally. Even asked that way, an overwhelming number of our samples said the economy was the most important issue to them. There are some slight differences depending on whether we look at what's the most important problem facing the United States and what's the most important problem to you personally. And that's in the second circle there. So you see some differences. So when asked in terms of what's most personally salient to you, things like the economy, things like unemployment, healthcare, and it's almost undiscernible down there, but education and immigration wind up becoming more salient. And the reason why it's really hard to notice these differences is because, again, the economy seems to be the single overriding issue for our respondents. Of the issues that we had the foresight to think to ask respondents about, I'm going to talk about four of them. The first is what people thought about universal access to healthcare. So we asked, please tell me if you agree or disagree about the following statement: the federal government should guarantee health care for everybody. The results are pretty unambiguous. Again, if you look to the rightmost orange column, which is the total sample results, More than 80% of our sample either agreed strongly or agreed somewhat that the federal government should guarantee health care for everybody. And even if you take a quick glance at the across ethnic subgroup differences, an overwhelming proportion of Asian Americans across all ethnic subgroups felt supportive of the idea that the federal government should guarantee access to health care for everybody. So among the different publics that are out there who really favor the idea of trying to guarantee access to health care, Asian Americans should be thought of as one of those groups. In this slide, on this issue, as in I think all of our public policy issues that we asked respondents about, we didn't see any marked differences between what our New York, New Jersey sample respondents had to say and what our national sample had to say. The next issue that we asked about was about the war in Iraq. So again, agree or disagree with the following statement: the U.S. should get our military troops out of Iraq as soon as possible. Here again, there's very strong support almost across almost every group. If you look at, again, at the rightmost column for the total, 68% of our sample either agreed strongly or somewhat about the U.S. getting our military troops out of Iraq as soon as possible. The one group that was more ambivalent than they were supportive were Vietnamese Americans. So only 33% agreed with that statement, and 42% felt that they could neither agree nor disagree with that statement. There's no group that really strongly disagreed with the idea of getting our troops out of Iraq. Then we asked about two really key questions about immigration policy. The first is on paths to citizenship as we hopefully move towards some kind of comprehensive immigration reform in the Obama administration. So this statement is, do you agree or disagree with the idea that the U.S. should provide a path to citizenship for people in this country illegally? And these results are quite interesting because if you're trying to mobilize Asian Americans in support of the idea of paths to citizenship, there's a lot of work to be done here. So if you look at our total sample again on the far right, only 31% of our sample agreed with the idea that there should be a path to citizenship for people who are in this country and undocumented. 45% disagreed with that statement, and 24% neither agreed nor disagreed. Similar results on our other question about immigration reform. So this is what people thought about the following statement: U.S. immigration policy should favor people with professional qualifications over those who already have family in the United States. And there's relatively high levels of agreement about favoring professional qualifications over family reunification. So 46% of our sample, total sample, agreed with that statement. Only 20% disagreed with that statement. And again, on this question, the foreign-born and New Yorkers were more likely to strongly agree with this statement as compared to the rest of the sample. Then I want to talk about a little bit about the role of parties. And it may seem like an odd place to think about describing Asian American politics, but in fact, for most political scientists, the starting and ending place is to focus on where parties are. Most card-carrying political scientists will tell you that nothing is a better explainer of who votes and who doesn't vote and how they vote and how they don't vote and what they think about different policy issues than whether or not they identify as a Democrat, Republican, or an independent. And a lot of political scientists who have tried to crack the nut of what the politics of these post-1965 immigration-based groups like Asian Americans and Latinos think about politics have really focused on the question of, are they going to be overwhelmingly Democratic like African Americans are they going to be Republican, or what the mix is. In a way, that's not looking at the obvious fact of what happens when you're looking at a population that is overwhelmingly foreign-born. And Asian Americans, if you take the adult sample of Asian Americans, are about 80% foreign-born. And that's the fact that a lot of Asian Americans are still ambivalent about the idea of party competition in the United States and don't have much of a view about parties in the United States. So the focus of most political scientists, which is this Democrat or Republican, if you look at the orange column, that's only 43% of the sample. So of people who know whether they identify as a Democrat or Republican, a much larger portion of Asian Americans identify as Democrats than do as Republicans. And that shouldn't be a surprise based on what Karthick talked about in terms of who they thought they were going to vote for in the 2008 presidential election. But 57% of our sample either identified as independents or simply said, I don't think in these terms. And for most political scientists who analyze the party identification question, anybody who doesn't identify as a Republican, Democrat, or Independent is just kind of thrown out of your data and not even considered. And that's 36% of the people that we interviewed. There are some interesting differences across groups. I focus here on the two largest groups in our New York, New Jersey sample, Asian Indians and Chinese Americans. Asian Indians are the group that one of the two groups with Japanese Americans were most likely to identify as Democrats as opposed to Republicans. Chinese Americans are the one group in our sample that's most likely to not think in partisan terms. So only 30% of Chinese Americans in our sample either identify as a Republican or Democrat. 70% say they're either independent or I just don't think in partisan terms. What consequences does this have? Parties remain a very important sort of anchoring institution in terms of helping people think about politics and mobilizing people into politics. So if you look at something like whether or not you're registered to vote, it matters a great deal whether or not you think in partisan terms. So people who are able to say, I'm a Republican, in that group, 75% are registered to vote. People who say were able to say, I think I'm a Democrat, 2 out of 3 are registered to vote. By the time you get down to Asian Americans in our sample who say, I just don't know how to think about political parties, only 40% in that group are registered to vote. So parties matter to bringing people into politics. And the last slide I'm going to show you on that important aspect of Asian American politics is party mobilization itself. So we asked people in the past 12 months, has a political party or candidate contacted you about a campaign? For our total sample, 25% reported that somebody, either a candidate or a party, had contacted them about a campaign in 2008. That number for our national sample is a fair bit larger than the number for the New York metro area, 19%. And to some extent that makes sense because in the presidential election of 2008, New York was expected to go towards a Democratic candidate. And you'll also see a fair bit of ethnic subgroup differences ranging from 39% of Japanese Americans who said they'd been contacted to only 15% of Vietnamese who said they'd been contacted. What's the importance of this? The importance of this can be seen in the following slide, which is how active people are in politics and what their political preferences are. So if you look down the columns, for people who said that they'd been contacted, 55% in that group were likely to have reported voting in the 2008 primaries. If you said you hadn't been contacted, only 41% said they'd voted in the primaries. We ran a likely voter model to try to predict who we thought would vote in November. Of the people who'd been contacted, 73% were likely to be voters in November. Of those who hadn't been contacted, 33% were likely to be voters. And then in terms of people's actual choices, if you hadn't been contacted, 43% in that group said they didn't know how they were going to vote in the presidential election. If you had been contacted, a lot of that high proportion of undecideds switches over to a preference for Barack Obama. I'm going to stop there and pass the mic over to Janelle Wong, who's a professor at the University of Southern California.
Hi, thanks for coming out tonight. So I'm going to talk about identity, race relations, and a little bit about where Asian Americans might be coalescing in the future with other groups. So we have some data on how do Asian Americans think about themselves? How do they self-identify? And our question was, people of Asian descent in the U.S. use different terms to describe themselves. In general, do you think of yourself as, and we had a number of different choices. The first was, do you think of yourself as Asian American? About 13% of our sample, many of you have seen this on the ground, actually identified as Asian American, that term. Most of our sample identify as a particular ethnic group, American, like Vietnamese American, for instance. One really interesting finding we have, and it's consistent with past studies, is that South Asians, Asian Indians in our sample, are the group most likely to identify as Asian American. And both, I think, on the ground and in the literature, you know, there has been a sense that South Asians have been marginalized within the larger Asian American kind of rubric. But in fact, it's interesting to see that Asian Indians actually identify at the highest rate as quote unquote Asian Americans. You can see some ethnic group differences here as well. Vietnamese Americans, we also show, are the group that is the most likely to identify in ethnic American terms. We also ask, you know, what is the meaning of being Asian American to you? So we ask, what, if anything, do Asians in the United States share with one another? Would you say that they share a common race, a common culture, common economic interests, common political interests? What brings this community together? How do they connect with one another? And I think this is one of the only questions like this I've seen. It's kind of interesting. So what we see is that 54% of Asian Americans think of Asian Americans as sharing a common race. 64% think that Asian Americans share a common culture. 54% claim that Asian Americans share a common economic interest. And very important for our study, which is primarily on politics, 36% of the sample believe that Asian Americans share common political interests. So in terms of organizing, this is, I think, an important finding, right? There's some work to be done out there. And we also asked, and I think this is important for thinking about coalitions. When we asked a pretty specific question, thinking about government services, political power, and representation, so sort of getting people oriented towards thinking about politics and the government, would you say Asian Americans have a lot in common? Some in common, little in common, or nothing at all in common with African Americans, Latinos, and whites? And what you see here is that Asian Americans feel that if you look at the first, that red line, you can see who do they think they have nothing in common with. Whites, they feel they have only 19%, or 19% of Asian Americans say that they feel they have nothing in common with whites. And if you go to follow that line, a larger proportion think they have nothing in common with blacks. But what's interesting also is that in terms of what they think they have a lot in common with, there's not a lot of difference between those groups, so they don't feel they have a lot in common with other groups. And again, I think this is something to highlight in terms of thinking towards the future. We also asked about discrimination, which really, I think, shapes people's views about their own identity and their connection with other groups. And we asked, in which ways have people experienced discrimination? And what you see here, the pie chart shows how many different instances people have been, in different contexts have people been, experienced discrimination. So about 21% of people say they've experienced discrimination in one context, like renting or buying a home, or at their job. You can see the kind of things we asked about, treatment by the police, getting promoted at work, or feeling discrimination towards in restaurants. And an additional 9%, so about 30% of people, have experienced at least one or two different types of discrimination. And this kind of gives you a picture of both the extent to which people are experiencing discrimination, but if you look at the chart on the right, you can also see where discrimination, at least in their self-reported view, is most prevalent. So we see that mostly people report being discriminated against in stores and restaurants, but we also see a fair amount of discrimination, over 10%, over 1 in every 10 Asian Americans in the nation report being treated unfairly by the police. And finally, we look at hate crimes. Have you ever been the victim of a hate crime? And we find that, again, 1 out of every 10 Asian Americans report being experiencing discrimination through hate crime. And we see that among some groups, especially South Asians, which is not a surprise after 9/11,
almost 14% of South Asians say that they have experienced a hate crime. And what
you might want to say that we defined it for them.
We did define it for them in this sense. We said that is, have you ever had someone verbally or physically abuse you or damage your property specifically because of your race or ethnicity? And kind of thinking about all of these slides together, I think one finding that isn't highlighted in the slide but is important to think about is that Asian Americans tend to, and this is some of Taeku Lee's work, they report experiencing a pretty high degree of racial discrimination, but when asked about which groups they think experience the most discrimination, they don't tend to think that even Asian Americans versus other groups like Latinos or African Americans experience the most discrimination. I'm going to shift gears to the last set of slides so that we can have some questions. And I'm going to talk about civic engagement beyond kind of the electoral context. So we ask people, and this I think is important in terms of organizing, well, where are Asian Americans organizing, right? So we ask them, other than a religious group or place of worship, is there any other group or organization in your community that you were involved with? And we see about 17% of Asian Americans say that they're involved in a community group or organization. We can also compare that to other types of civic engagement. In this case, we ask, do you attend a religious place of worship at least once a week? And about 30% of Asian Americans say that they do. And if you look at that row, the middle line, you can see that there's a lot of variation between groups. Those groups that are more heavily Christian and Catholic tend to attend a place of worship more. That's not necessarily surprising. And also to take part in more activities beyond just attending the Sunday service. This is important because what we see is that belonging to a community organization and also being involved in other types of civic institutions tends to be associated with participating in civic life in other ways, especially in terms of registering to vote. Finally, we asked about civic mobilization. So we asked, not did a party contact you, but did any other organization contact you? That means, you know, community group, we actually explicitly said, like a union, community group, or an organization outside of parties and political campaigns. And you can again see that there's variation, and it might not be in the ways that you expect in terms of which groups get contacted. So Filipinos, 1 out of 5 Filipinos in the nation reports being contacted by a community organization, similar to Koreans. And in contrast, Asian Indians report some of the lowest rates. You can see here at the very end that about 10% of New York, New Jerseyans, report being contacted by a civic organization compared to 14% of the nation. And what are the implications of this? What we see is similar to contact matters. And contact is very much associated with other types of engagement. So we see that among those who were contacted, 57% say that they were they voted in the primary, they self-reported voting in the primary. Among those who weren't contacted, 43% said the same thing. And among those who were contacted by, this is now, remember, not a partisan organization, civic organization, almost 70%, we predicted with our model would be likely voters in November. And then finally, if you look down at the last three rows, you can see that among those who were contacted, they tended to be Obama supporters. Among those who were not contacted, they tended to be undecided voters. So I'm going to just wrap up. I wanted, before we completed, to just acknowledge both our institutions and also our funders. We're funded by the Russell Sage Foundation, the James Irvine Foundation, Eagleton, and Carnegie Corporation. And also to say a really special thanks to Andrew Hahn and to Safeforth Shaw, and also to Christine Chen, who helped to coordinate all the organizations that were supporting this event,
to all of the organizations who came out and participated, and finally to Anna Murphy, who's been our research assistant here in New York City. So thank you so much again. We'd love to take your questions.
Floor's open.
You can do a second food run.
Do you have the information on the economic and income breakdown of the sample? Did it mirror the Asian American population in the U.S. or the Asian American, or the American population as a whole?
Yeah, one thing we did in our survey is that whenever you go out and collect, do these surveys, they're not going to exactly mirror what the population looks like. So we need to apply what people call weights to make it representative again. One issue that we have on income is that a lot of Asian Americans don't like talking about how much money they have. So was it about a quarter? 20% of the sample we don't have income data for. There are ways that we're looking to try to fix it statistically by predicting what those incomes would be based on occupation, based on education, how long they've been here, things like that. But we have other measures of socioeconomic status, like home ownership, like education, to be able to talk about.
I think if the question, maybe the spirit of the question is this a representative sample? And I think that, or to what extent does it represent or overrepresent certain populations? And we took great care not only in the weighting of the sample, but in getting people to take part in the survey. One thing that you should know, there are very, very few studies of Asian Americans in the United States, period. There are some very good ones in local areas, and there have been very good ones. Other ones that are not necessarily representative, but let's say exit poll data, which are also extremely useful. But one of the biggest problems with doing national surveys, if you see anything reported in the national press, I hope there's somebody from the national press here, about surveys done, there are maybe 50, 60 Asian Americans in those samples. It's very unreliable, not only because the numbers are so small, but because, as Karthick mentioned at the beginning, surveys are taken in English only and Spanish. So unless you're an Asian American who speaks Spanish or English, you can't take the survey and you wouldn't take it. And that results in a disproportionate look at the Asian American population. So with respect to income, there is a relationship between income and English language ability. And so we took great care in interviewing subjects and in finding subjects that were not only fluent in English, but could give the interview in their native language. And so as a result, this is probably the best survey, most representative survey with respect to all of those characteristics, because we were able to interview in 8 languages.
I'll just continue on in the Rashomon answer to your question by slicing it a slightly different way, which is to take your question to be, were there ways in which our sample is different from the Asian American population in the country as a whole? In terms of education and income, I can't think of anything that really jumps out. There are a few things that do jump out. So our sample is more male than most public opinion samples, which tend to be more female than male. We have actually, I think, 55% men and 45% women. Our sample is older than the Asian American general population, so we don't have as many young Asian Americans, and that's obviously a group that's really interesting to a lot of people, especially politically. Karthick mentioned earlier, because of our funders, our sample is disproportionately weighted towards certain areas of the country, and that means it's also disproportionately underweighted in other parts of the country. And two in particular that I can think of on top of my head are Illinois and Hawaii. So states that have large Asian American populations that weren't part of our funder base wind up being underrepresented in our sample. And just two more. One is our sample is also slightly more foreign-born than the Asian American population as a whole. And because we sampled based on matching first names and last names, our sample is less multiracial than the Asian American population.
Yes, everybody said.
So the way Asian American is defined in any study like ours depends on how you decide who you're going to study. So the way we decided, made that decision, was to really focus on the six largest ethnic subgroups, so which we showed in our slides, so Asian Indians, Chinese, Filipinos, Japanese, Koreans, and Vietnamese.
Yes.
Is a partially of the answer. My question was basically, again, I was kind of curious to find out under, you know, what basis you came up with these sample categories, because your study assumes that South Asia equals India, and there is no mention anywhere of Bangladesh or Pakistan, and Nepal is, you know, not far behind either. And regionally speaking, in New York metro area, Bangladeshi population is very sizable, and also Pakistani, and also Nepali. And we don't seem to count them anywhere.
Right. I'll repeat the question, which is, both these questions at the front were asking about the national origin diversity here, and especially on the South Asians. And believe me, for someone, I've been involved in this from the very beginning of this project, and it was a very painful thing not to be able to include other South Asian groups, and this is the reason why we weren't able to include it. There are two ways that one can try to do a representative survey of Asian Americans. One is to just randomly dial phone numbers and ask for someone to talk to, and if they're not Asian, you hang up the phone. We tried doing that because some social scientists said that's the true way to do it. And we'd get people regardless of their national origin. Well, it turns out that, you know, it costs over $500 per survey to do that, and we would have run out of money by doing, you know, just a few hundred interviews. So the other alternative is to rely on lists, and the list that exists, Catalyst is one of the most sophisticated firms when it comes to producing ethnic targeting lists, but they find a lot of difficulty in assigning classifications for Muslim origin populations, regardless of their ethnicity, and differentiating Bangladeshis and Pakistanis from other Muslims. I think their methodology could be improved, quite honestly, and I think one of the things that we would like to do when we go back to a firm like Catalyst is to offer suggestions of thinking about distinctive South Asian Muslim names that could help improve that sample. And one thing I should note is that we do have, and this is not necessarily a satisfactory answer, we do have people from various national origins, including Bangladeshi, Pakistani, Thai, in this Asian other category, but that is not big enough. For most of the other limitations that Taeku talked about, we have the advantage of sample size to overcome those limitations because the survey is so big. But we cannot overcome that limitation when it comes to South Asians who were not classified as such by the sample that we got. But that's a very valid point. And one thing I would say, if there are any funders in the room or if there are people here who, it would be good, this is a good achievement, but I think we can certainly improve on this in 2012. But what that means is that it'll take a lot more resources than we were able to raise. And we raised somewhere around $500,000 to do the survey. Oh, a follow-up question.
Not really a question, but a comment. I raised this issue because some years ago, I had a conversation with one of the senior officers at the city planning who was responsible for census information. At that time, he indicated that in New York area, among South Asian communities, the Bangladeshi community was becoming as one of the most dynamic and fast changing and growing communities in every aspect, socioeconomic, whatever you want to call it, as well as politically. So if the engagement is greater in certain areas, obviously the impact in that particular field is also going to be greater. And so my only comment is that if you had, for example, identified few the Bangladeshi community-based organizations or Pakistani or Nepali, and you know, reach out through those organizations, the sample would probably be more balanced. That is the only thing.
That's a really good point. One thing we wanted to get also, though, is, you know, it's important to get a range of people, including those not affiliated with any particular organization, so that they, because people who are part of an organization actually tend to look a little bit different than the general population. So I think that would be a great starting point. I think we would love to work with more organizations, both on the fundraising and on the outreach, and especially how do you reach those folks who aren't actually affiliated with organizations, right? Because they do tend to look pretty distinct from other
organizations. I didn't mean to suggest that you work with those organizations, but you know, ask those organizations to identify some community members.
This was another huge issue we ran into, because if you look at people who live in enclaves, they also look different than those who don't. And so we try to do some outreach through these listed names, so that we're not just targeting high density areas and those people who tend to live in high density areas. I mean, it's a thorny problem, and we've been struggling with this too. I really appreciate you bringing these issues to the fore.
I'll just say very quickly, I am fully sympathetic to what you're saying. I've done some other research on the effect of trying to get people in a community together to talk about politics, on how politically active they are and what their political viewpoints are. And in that project, we adopted exactly the approach that you're suggesting. And the people that were able to recruit to come out and spend a day talking about something like healthcare reform really wind up, even though all we're doing is going out to community-based organizations and having them tell us people to try to reach out, the people who actually wind up showing up look really different from the general population. So it's really sort of a question of who do we want to try to say something about? And the really big gap in talking about Asian American politics was really to be able to try to say something about the community as a whole. Most surveys try to just say something about 300 million Americans by interviewing just 1,000 people. How do you do that in a representative way? Really by trying to make it as random as possible and as representative as possible. It's really difficult.
Can you just speak to what your goals are to do with the findings?
The question is, now you've collected this data, what do you plan to do with it? And one thing, we're trying to disseminate it through forums like this, and through we're working with APAL in Los Angeles, Asian Pacific American Legal Center Los Angeles, to be part of their civil rights conference in the fall, and trying to look for opportunities to share the data through the web and in other ways. And we're also trying to write a book. If people have ideas for ways in which we can use this data in ways that we can partner, I think we would be really open to talking to you. But those are the main plans. It's sort of a lot of community-based forums like this, and then also some publications.
One other thing that we are trying to do is to really amp up our website, so that any government agencies or community-based organizations who have a very specific interest out of our data based on the state that they're in or the city they're in can directly ask and get an instantaneous answer to whatever it is that they're interested in finding out about from our data set.
See, another thing I was going to say is, and this will be preaching to the choir, but it's a little bit frustrating to, because a lot of times people say, well, we don't really know much about what Asian Americans think because there is no information out there. And we've put this information out there for several months now, so their mainstream media reporting on things like healthcare reform really should be talking about how Asian Americans are some of the strongest supporters of universal healthcare, but I have yet to see a story that has a mainstream news story that has an Asian American angle on healthcare reform, except maybe talking about doctors and what they think about it. So that's something that I think all of us need to call these mainstream institutions out in terms of their lack of coverage. On immigration reform, I think what it shows you, or shows all of us, is that the community organizations may be in a different place from where the residents are, and we need to do a lot of work if Asian Americans are going to be important political partners when it comes to comprehensive immigration reform.
I just want to add one more thing to that, and that is that this is 2008, and this is the very first national survey, political survey of Asian Americans. So that's a little bit, when we were telling people we were doing this, people said, are you kidding? There's no studies of Asian Americans, and there aren't. We're 5% of the U.S. population, in particular in certain states like New York, New Jersey, California, Virginia, Illinois, Texas, Florida. There are much larger proportions than that. And one of the things we'd like to do with this study is to force public opinion researchers to really take the Asian American population seriously. You can't do a survey, or you shouldn't do a survey of the U.S. population without taking Asian Americans into consideration. So one of the larger frames for the study, I think, is to draw attention to the kinds of methodologies that you would need to use to appropriately, and I think to embellish on those methodologies to make it a truly representative sample. So beyond the research products and the information that we will provide, and the information that we can provide not only to media sources but to community organizations, is to make a statement about the significance of the Asian American population politically in the United States. And I think that this is a first step in doing so. We would like to, I think if we are still walking, you know, be able to do this again in 2012.
Sort of a related question, but I wanted to know if there are thoughts about tying this data to policy recommendations.
I think mostly in deference to expertise elsewhere in this room and in other forums, I think at least our hope is that when we can present findings, and we'd love to be in conversation with advocates if they have specific policy recommendations in mind, from looking, there's one way in which we can just show the data and say this is what the data is, but there's a lot of expertise in forums like these among people in the audience in terms of, okay, what's the next step? How do we message this? Where do we need to work? What are the different kinds of audiences that we need to push this message to? Most of us, unfortunately, in the front of the room here, are not as expert as you guys on that. That's the way I punt on that question.
I think there are some really specific things, though, and it's more about making sure that whether it's at the federal, state, or local level, people are looking at the right places that they actually kind of make people's lives better. So if you're really working on hate crimes and you're not looking at whether or not Asian Americans are victims of hate crimes, then you're not looking at the right places. If you're looking to try to bring people out in an election and you're not offering in-language ballots or in-language election materials, you're not really trying to reach out to everybody. If you're looking at discrimination and you're looking at police abuse of power, and you're not, and you're only looking at Harvard and Cambridge and tenured professors there, you're not looking at the right places. So I think, this is our role as researchers, is to try to use the skills that we have to try to get the best possible information out there. And then the role of government agencies and advocacy groups and community-based organizations, hopefully, is to try to use that to be able to do the work that they do. I mean, one of our real hopes is that we'll have the kind of information that some of you will be able to use in writing grant proposals that are successful, so that you can then do the kind of work that you guys do and do it better. So, I think those are some of the things that we hope to get out of this study.
Do you have lessons learned and recommendations for how the census is done?
That's it. Lessons learned on how the census is done. I don't know if my collaborators think about what I'll have to say about this, but
talk about CPS.
Yes, that's what I want to talk. So most people, when they try to get a sense of where Asian Americans are in terms of voter registration, citizenship, and voter turnout, will look at the current population surveys, which has the advantage of literally just calling random telephone numbers and getting people to respond. So in that way, it's possibly more representative, except if the person on the other end of the line doesn't speak English, the conversation ends there.
Or Spanish.
Or Spanish. I thought the next year, really?
It's Spanish.
Okay. So if you're talking about a community where, you know, if our estimates are right, and I think our estimates are probably maybe low, 40% of the people you want to reach out to can't talk to you in English, then you're not going to know anything about their citizenship, naturalization rates, whether or not they're registered to vote, whether or not they voted. And that's the benchmark that most people use. So I think, in terms of Census 2010, I think it's a little bit trickier because I don't know a whole lot about how undercounted Asian Americans are relative to other groups. And I think this is going to be a year where people are going to fight over limited resources in terms of where to try to target mobilization efforts in terms of undercounts. Beyond that, it gets into, I mean, for me, like really dicey territory in terms of racial categories.
One thing I noticed, I was heavily involved in how the sample was drawn up, and one thing I noticed is that for, this wasn't a high frequency, but high enough that I paid attention to this, in which some people had a couple of different addresses, and one address in the country and one address outside the country. So the extent to which, you know, there's the census day in which everyone gets enumerated on that day, Asian Americans potentially could get undercounted if they don't happen to be in their place of residence during the day or the month that enumeration takes place. We're not experts in exactly how, but I think a lot of people don't know exactly how the 2010 census is going to be run. But that's something to potentially pay attention to, given that, you know, 80% of the Asian American adult population is foreign-born, 60% of the resident Asian American population is foreign-born. We need to pay attention to population movement.
I think there are a number of different census sources, right? So we need to be clear about them. There's an enumeration, which will take place in much the same way enumerations have always taken place. So when a counter goes out there to count, if you haven't turned in your form, more likely to get a co-ethnic, someone who speaks the language. So it's less of a problem there. But we're no longer going to have the census long form. So if you've had block and track data that you used to use, it doesn't exist anymore. So the long form's not going out anymore. It's been replaced by the American Community Survey, which is a telephone study. And in this case, we have the same problems with that study as we would with CPS. So the really great block level data, track data that we used to get will no longer be based on an enumeration form that is a longer identification form that people fill out themselves or that the census taker will go out and do many times with the ability in language. So I think that the disappearance of the census long form and its replacement by American Community Survey, without the methodologies to account for foreign language requirement, and in our case, many languages, many more than eight that we've interviewed only in this survey, will exacerbate the problem even further. It's a big problem for, in particular, areas like New York City, which has incredibly diverse populations. So I think it's a major issue. I don't even know I don't know who the director of the census is anymore. So, you know, maybe we should write a memo. Any other questions? Yes. One in the back, please.
I was just wondering what percentage of Asian Americans contributing to political campaigns is compared to the general public.
How much smaller is it? So the question is, what proportion of the U.S. population, how much greater is it? I think the number is 9, right? The 16?
I don't know. I wasn't able to understand that.
Was it 16? It's 12. It's about, in the U.S. population, it depends by the year. So this, as you know, this study was took place during an election year in 2008, and the data for, varies, in fact, quite significantly by state. I think it's probably between 4 to 8% less than the U.S. population.
Just a quick, the eight languages and the 40% of the sample you mentioned, are the interviewees were interviewed in their own language?
Yes.
Was that because they did not understand or communicate in English? Or there was another purpose of doing
So the question was about the 40% of our sample that was interviewed in a non-English language, and the question is whether it was a function of the way we did design our survey, or whether we had some other motive behind trying to do it that way. People think of surveys as some sort of magic scientific device, like an electrode into the American brain or something like that, but it's basically just a telephone conversation, and it's a telephone survey like any other telephone conversation. And we have a series of filtering questions at the very beginning of our conversation where we try to determine if you are a person who identifies as Asian and lives in the United States. And when we start that conversation, one of the first questions is, are you comfortable having this conversation in English, or would you prefer speaking to in another language? And when we assign our interviewers, because we work off of a list that tries to match individual, that tries to give each person on that list a likelihood that they're Asian, and if so, a likelihood of what ethnic group they belong to, ahead of time we try to match interviews to the person's likely ethnic group and try to assign interviewers that speak both English and the likely non-English language that that person would have to interview. So if the person right away says, however they choose to say it, that I prefer to have this conversation in another language, then hopefully we'd have the person right there who can then switch to another language, and if not, then they're assigned to a different interview.
So in this case, would we safely assume that those are either older respondents or maybe more recently arrived in?
Both, yes, they're both.
The question is, so are there certain characteristics that are associated with speaking another language? Let me step back and also say, if someone seems like they can't understand even the first sentence of that telephone call, the survey firm would have someone who, they make an assumption, they listen to the person, and let's say they think it's someone who speaks Korean, then the Korean interviewer will call back fairly shortly after that, anyone who hangs up, because it seems like there's a language barrier. Yes, there are definitely characteristics associated with speaking another language, and we can see that in the data that, they tend to be more recent immigrants. We did not have a quota for how many people would speak. We didn't choose 40%. So, yes, the things that you would think are associated tend to be associated, and it's very clear in the data here.
When we did this survey, were they legal?
It's not, whoever answers the phone. We don't ask them about their legal status.
I think we have time for a couple more questions. Christine reminds me that we still have plenty of food in the back, so please do partake of that more. And another thing I should also note is that as we're working on this book, working on other publications, we hope to release this data towards the latter half of next year. But in the meantime, if people have suggestions in terms of really important things from even looking at these PowerPoint slides that we should be highlighting, that we're not highlighting, please email us, because that will improve what we do. Oh, the website is on the final slide. No, it's on the final slide. You're going back.
Yes.
There's one more slide. No, it's all the way. Wait. So, I don't mean this as a way to cut off the conversation, but there have been people who have been filtering out. But again, it's naasurvey.com. I saw some people trying to take photographs of these different sites. In a few hours, it'll be up on there. So, but please do give us your suggestions in terms of how we should try to frame the importance of some of these things. Because we do want the various articles that we write or the books that we write to be helpful to community organizations.
What areas were covered by Metro New York?
So Metro New York is it's the counties in New York City, Long Island, county. So the definition that we use is the definition that the Census Bureau uses in defining the New York metro region. So Northeast counties in New Jersey, New York City, counties immediately north of New York City and east of New York City. Okay, someone who hasn't asked a question.
Sure. I wanted to know, were there any stark contrasts between like urban areas, more rural, or like Midwest areas? You mentioned new gateways like Las Vegas, Charlotte, and Dallas, versus like West Coast and East Coast, because the East Coast has a weaker Asian American political base than say California, which is phenomenal, or Hawaii, which is phenomenal too. So we'd like to still push like the East Coast effort. Boston, New York, so did you notice
that? Right, in terms of the geographic differences, we're still now starting to, we're adding a lot of geographic data, not just where people live, but you know whether they live in a white majority area or a black majority area or a Latino majority area. So we're still in the process of doing that. One thing I can say just from our glance at the data in terms of new destinations versus traditional destinations is the ethnic media use is a huge difference. As one might expect, people who live in traditional destinations are much more likely to be exclusively reliant on Asian language media to get their news about politics. And that's very different from people living in newer destinations. We expected this to be a huge difference across the board, and we're not seeing that yet. So that's important to take note of as well, that maybe we're not that different after all from the East and West Coast.
Yeah, I was thinking back onto the slide about likelihood to vote for a candidate of your same ethnicity. Do you think that there's any role of Asian American appointees or existing elected officials in determining undecided voters into a political party?
So the question is on this, on the co-ethnic voting. What you're asking, does and could some sort of symbolic representation make a difference to mobilize people? Is that what?
Right. Does say a high number of Asian American appointees by a certain party affect?
Like Obama,
or okay. President Bush, or governors?
Right. So
steer a community into a particular party.
Well, that's a great question. That's a question political scientists have tried to figure out for some time, right? So what significance does it make a difference? I mean, when you're in college. And you go all the way through college, let's say you're not an engineer, let's say you're in political science or humanities, and you go all the way through college and you never see anybody up there in front of the classroom that resembles you or people that come from your family. Does that make a difference? I mean, it's the same kind of a question, right? So what significance does a symbolic or a sort of a trait that you can see, you know, when I look and I see the Secretary of Energy, would that make a difference to me? I don't think we know. Political scientists have tried for a long time to see whether that would make a difference. I think there's very little research. There's a little bit of research that I've done that it's where you do an experiment and you give half of the room, let's say half the room, the first 10 rows, you give them a photograph, in this case of a U.S. cabinet official, and those cabinet officials happen to be Asian American. And you say, here's some important people who happen to be Asian American. And then you ask them questions afterward about their level of ethnic and racial identity. And then you compare them to people who haven't seen the photograph and aren't reminded that there are important people in the federal government who are Asian American. And you ask them the same questions about political identity. What do you think you find?
Higher rates.
You're right. You do find much higher rates of a sense of ethnic identification when they have seen a representation of themselves. Now, whether or not that identity matters to political behavior, would it make them more likely to vote? Would it make them more likely to come and register or go to a meeting? Unknown. But with respect to their sense of who they are, seeing a photograph, being reminded that legitimate political figures at the national level are Asian American makes a difference.
Well, I mean, this question has been very, I won't say well studied, it's been very often studied with respect to African Americans. And some studies find that it has an effect in increasing African American voter turnout. Some studies find it has an effect in decreasing African-American voter turnout. Some studies find that it has an effect on increasing the level of trust that African-Americans have in politics, and some studies seem to not find a relationship. On this question, I'll take my NAAS hat off and say, I think the current Obama administration can't help but be a potentially pivotal moment in the history of Asian Americans in U.S. politics, just because of the sheer number of Asian Americans that Obama has appointed to cabinet level positions and below cabinet level positions, and has had in his sort of White House staff. I think if you're Asian American, it's really hard not to notice that. In fact, I just wrote a few months ago an essay with Michael Omi at UC Berkeley talking about Obama as the first Asian American president, partly based on what he's actually done as opposed to his biography. But I think it could be a defining moment in terms of whether or not Asian Americans even more overwhelmingly align with one party as opposed to another. In terms of their party identification, it's really mixed, as we talked about. In terms of how they voted in the last few elections, there's been a discernible trend. It's not like a political earthquake, but there's been a discernible trend in terms of what we see in exit polls in terms of a higher and slightly higher proportion of Asian Americans who seem to vote for the Democratic presidential candidate anyway. And I think this current Obama administration could really push much harder in that direction, but as with any kind of pivotal moment, it could go either way. I mean, I think one really bad political scandal, and I think it could all blow up. I mean, just think about how Bill Clinton responded to the campaign finance scandal involving Asian Americans. It was really like trying to wash his hands of Asian Americans very, very quickly. So, I mean, I think. It could be a really pivotal moment, but it could go in either direction.
Yes, well, I think they're off the same slide. What is the difference between Asian Americans and the population as a whole on protest and writing letters?
Protest, it's the same. In fact, for some populations, it's higher. Asian Americans are more likely by a small number to, in this case it looks like it's 4, which is about the same as the U.S. population. Okay. In terms of writing a letter, contacting an official, it's much lower, by about 10%. So Asian Americans are less likely to contact a government official. And we want to figure out why that's the case. So we'll look at who the people are, and we have questions, for example, on whether you feel comfortable speaking and writing in English, because if you're going to contact a U.S. official, you're going to do it in English. And so we wonder into what extent, even among the people who are well-educated, that number is well-educated, even educated in the United States, it's lower. I don't think we've done the analysis for second generation beyond.
No, I don't think so. And the thing about contact, before I was an academic, I was a researcher at the Public Policy Institute of California, and we had some data sets that had, given the number of Asian Americans in California, even if you did a representative survey of California, you'd be able to compare across groups. And Asian Americans, even there, were less likely to write to elected officials. And I think this provides a potential opportunity for community organizations. So they shouldn't just try to get people naturalized and get them registered to vote, because a lot of elected officials pay attention to who's writing those personalized individual letters. And if Asian Americans are much less likely to do that, they are being shut out of some very important policymaking processes. So one potential suggestion, it's difficult to suggest this in bad budget times, but when funding for CBOs goes up again, to not just keep the eye on the prize of getting people naturalized or getting people registered to vote, but getting people the skills and the kind of personal sense of empowerment to be able to write a letter to their representatives when an issue concerns them.
I mean, we're all piggyback off that same question. I was wondering if you guys asked a question about whether or not they were they participated in politics in their home country.
Yes, and it's on the slide.
It's a very small percent. So the question was, do people participate in politics in their home country? One slide.
Yes, I have it up.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And then there's still, I mean, is there any sense of whether or not that level of participation informs or relates to the participation in this country?
Question is, how related is that item in terms of do you participate at home? Do you participate in the United States? Highly correlated.
Yeah.
They're more likely, if you participate in the politics of your country at home, you're more likely to participate in the United States.
Yeah, so there's no trade-off. Yeah.
Yes, it's not one or the other.
Okay.
And one more, last question.
It's a really a comment and a question. First of all, this is very useful, and I hope those of you who are involved in this area continue to do this kind of work or encourage some other regional and local groups to do the same thing. Secondly, this information can be very useful for Asian American community-based organizations to do their advocacy work. Very useful. And I would only suggest that if, based on this information and other research out there, if you could draw some recommendations for these community-based organizations to make big out of these recommendations and say, this is what they should yet say. You know, for example, you know, the data about the Asian Americans not writing letters to their representatives and so on and so forth, we can go to the community and say, well, you know, you got to write letters. We have a proof you don't write, right?
Right.
Similarly, I mean, there are more important issues. So if you could come up with a few list of policy recommendations, I think that would be...
Yeah, and the thing is that Janelle mentioned that in the fall, there's going to be this civil rights forum. So, and we are going to produce a kind of brochure type of report for that. So I think that would be a good opportunity to, I think essentially kind of give some talking points, give some ways of framing this so that people can easily latch onto things and kind of mobilize the communities around those things.
Like for example, I think around 2000, the New York Immigration Coalition here have done an exit poll study of the immigrant participation in the political process. And those are the kind of information it's very useful when we and they do the advocacy work in the communities, whether we go down to Washington DC with 500 people or to the Albany or City Hall, it makes a big difference because of that kind of information.
Right. Well, thank you all for coming out. As Christine said, there's a lot of food, so please help us clean up by eating.